The 20th century gave us so many misconceptions when it came to health.
Cutting down on meat is a good idea.
In Fat Part 1, we talk about the war for information. But I actually think we also live in a war with ourselves.
People are becoming guinea pigs.
Trying to get our system to do what it's not supposed to do.
Today we're going to explore all of the vitamins and nutrients you might need on a vegan diet.
Vitamin B12.
Calcium.
Iron.
Choline.
Vitamin D.
Selenium.
When you go on a vegan diet, you're cutting out a bunch of crap, a bunch of processed food in your life. But at some point, it's not sustainable.
Iodine.
Neurologic disorders.
Zinc.
Can be deficient in vegan diets.
Eat this. Eat that. Don't eat this. Don't eat that.
They were yelling like, don't eat chickens. Don't eat meat. I love chicken.
We have more questions than ever.
We have lost the faith of the public.
And sometimes even the people who are so-called experts don't know what's going on.
Sugar makes insulin work better and cures diabetics.
This study says this. That study says that.
Fat tends to cause you to be fat.
When you're in a club and they keep telling you the same thing in the club, and this is the only way it is, and you never see any other viewpoint, you just start believing.
And it throws your body into a state of emergency. That's what ketosis is.
People will say to me emphatically, well, keto is bad.
Keto crotch.
They're desperate.
Bacterial vaginosis.
If you have a sandwich or something right now, you might just want to go ahead and put that down.
And I'll ask why, and there's no answer. They'll just go, it's bad.
So I actually have not done keto myself, as you might guess, but...
So is the pendulum swinging back in the opposite direction? If America is so worried about its health, how do we get so fat?
Vinny Tortorich's Fat, a documentary, part 2. Available now for pre-order and released January 1st, 2021 on iTunes.
I believe that everybody has a story, and I'm fascinated to hear them. So come with me as we take a walk down Fascination Street.
Welcome back, Streetwalkers. A few months back, when I was being interviewed by Vinny Tortorich for his podcast, Fitness Confidential, I mentioned that I had interviewed BJ Thomas for the 50th anniversary of the song Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head. Vinny said, hey, at the end of that song, isn't that Herb Alpert playing the trumpet? And I said, I have absolutely no idea. And then I got to thinking about it, and I thought, why not ask Herb Alpert? So I reached out to Herb's people, and they were kind enough to make this episode happen. So thank you, Vinny, for the inspiration to reach out to Herb's people. And thank you, Adriana, for making this happen. Spoiler alert, in all of my excitement to speak with the great Herb Alpert, I completely forgot to ask him if that was him at the end of the song Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head by BJ Thomas. Oops. But... this is that conversation with legendary trumpeter and record producer Herb Alpert. Herb has had 5 number one albums, 28 albums on the Billboard Top 100, 14 platinum albums, and 15 gold albums. Plus, he has 9 Grammy Awards and has sold over 72 million records worldwide and counting. He also has the distinction of being the only musician to hit number one on the U.S. Billboard 100 as both a vocalist for This Guy's in Love with You and an instrumentalist for Rise. And in this episode, we talked to Herb about where he grew up and why he decided not to get into the family business, what steered him in the direction of music, and some of the decisions that he made along the way that helped further his career, give him a unique signature sound, and cement his status as an American music icon. We also talk a little bit about the problem with analyzing art in its many forms. Plus, Herb lets me play a couple of his biggest hits. This was recorded during all the self-distancing due to the coronavirus outbreak. So if that is over by now, woohoo! If not... damn it. But either way, this is my conversation with the incomparable Herb Alpert.
Yeah, talk to me, yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, streetwalkers, we have a special guest here today. This man is a trumpeter, a composer, a record producer, a fine artist. He's had 9 Grammys. I'm sorry, he's won 9 Grammys. He's had 15 gold albums and 14 platinum albums. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome the legendary Herb Alpert.
Hey, Steve, how you doing?
I am fantastic. How you doing today, sir?
I wish I could say I'm fantastic. I feel good. I don't feel fantastic.
Well, maybe as it gets a little later in the day, you'll feel fantastic.
Yeah, well, that's true. Yeah, where are you? I'm probably a couple hours earlier.
Yeah, I'm in San Antonio. It's noon here.
All right. I'll be fantastic for our interview.
Well, that's awesome. So, first of all, thank you for taking this time. I appreciate it. You are a legend, sir, so I am humbled to even be speaking with you. Thank you.
Wow. I don't even know. What does that mean? I'm a legend. Does that mean you can't talk to me?
Yeah, that's kind of what it means. Yeah, I'm humbled. So, Herb, I like to start with where people were born and raised. So, hit me with that. Where were you born and raised, man?
Well, I was born in East L.A., and lived there for a couple of years before we moved closer to the Fairfax District.
Now, I understand that your dad has sort of a fascinating story. Can you talk a little bit about him?
He had a kind of an interesting background. You know, my dad was Russian. He came to this country when he was 16 years old, didn't speak a word of English, on a boat by himself, landed Ellis Island, and worked his way into, you know, doing what he wanted to do in life, and became moderately successful and pretty proud. You know, he had a mandolin that he brought with him, and he used to play mandolin by ear. He didn't read music, but he had this really nice feeling when he played, as though his nostrils would flare out, and he would play these songs, kind of like Russian songs, I guess. And it was fun listening to him, but I always got that feeling, you know, when you do something with authenticity, it doesn't matter how qualified you are, as long as you're sending an emotional message. And he was sending an emotional message when he played mandolin.
What was it that he did professionally?
He used to manufacture ladies' coats and suits.
Oh, cool.
And had a really good flair for that. You know, he used to design his own pieces, and he was following his dream, and he was good at it.
Yeah, I feel like back in the day, the fashion industry was basically all men. I feel like it was men designing, men manufacturing, men sewing. I feel like it was all men back then.
Well, he had a little office in downtown Los Angeles, and there were, you know, several women working the clothes. And he wanted me to be into that business, but I just couldn't get it. I didn't get it at all. I've been playing trumpet since I was 8. I had this lucky break when I was in grammar school. There was a music appreciation class there, and picked up the trumpet, and the trumpet started making noise that I couldn't get out of my mouth, because I'm an introvert, and I was really an introvert when I was a kid. But the trumpet was talking for me, and it's taken me a long and winding road, man.
All right, well, let's talk about those early days. So I know that maybe, let's just say, if the kid who lives next door to me decides to bring home a trumpet, I'm going to be pretty pissed off for most of the day, because this kid's going to be wailing on this trumpet and he doesn't know how. So walk me through how that works back in the day.
You mean with the neighbors yelling at me, that type of thing?
Yeah, maybe the parents too.
Well, my mom took care of that. You know, she would yell back at them. My mom was very supportive. She got the feeling that I had something on this horn. And it took a while to make some sense out of it, because you just don't blow hot air into a trumpet. You know, you have to learn how to buzz into the mouthpiece, etc. And then when I started having fun playing it, you know, I got really excited about practicing, because you don't get any place without practicing. And as I tell kids, you know, the secret of my success, blah, 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 I said, look it, while you're sleeping, someone else is practicing who wants the same thing you do. So you got to put in the time.
Well, that makes sense. So I'm assuming there was a lot of practice going on when you were younger that led into your wildly successful musical career. Where did you get, I guess, the drive? Like, you know, I used to love to skateboard when I was a kid, but I wasn't practicing it hours and hours and hours a day. So what gave you the drive to do that?
I guess little by little, as I started getting better at playing, I was an athlete. You know, I liked all the sports. I played football, baseball, basketball. I was very small. You know, I was like 5'3 when I entered high school, so I wasn't able to really get onto the football team or do the other sports. So I got involved in gymnastics, and I became, you know, a gymnast. I was, worked on the rings. At that period, they had the still rings and also the flying rings, which was really, it was fun for me, and I enjoyed it very much. And I grew when I was 17 or so. Then I shot up. I was about the last 6 months or 4 months of high school, the football coach came up to me and said, "Hey, you look like you could be on the football team." I said, "I'll be out of here in 4 months. We're too late."
Okay, so I know that, you know, a lot of people have an idea of what they want to be when they grow up, you know, while they're in high school. And I know that your dad was in fashion and you didn't really get what he was doing. Like, it didn't speak to you, so you didn't really want to go down that path. But what did you want to be when you grew up?
Well, I really didn't know. I became professional musician at 16. I joined the union here in Los Angeles, and I was lucky enough to play with different little groups on weekends. I earned a nice living doing that. I wasn't thinking of doing that the rest of my life. I really didn't know. I was searching. I was just looking around. And I found myself trying to play like the trumpet players that I liked, you know, like Louis Armstrong and Miles Davis and Harry James and the likes in that particular period. And then it hit me. I said, man, who in the heck wants to hear that? They've already done it. So I set out looking for my own voice, my own sound. And that's when things really started to happen.
Okay. Thank you for bringing that up, because that segues into a question I was going to ask you a little bit later. So I guess that's why you decided you needed to have a new sound. How did you go about finding and creating your own sound? Because you do have a very distinctive sound. So how did you go about taking a little bit from jazz and taking a little bit from classical and stuff like that? How did you end up compiling your sound?
Well, gee whiz, I was listening to some of the pop records of the day, and with the voices, some of the artists were stacking their voices. Then when I heard this record, How High the Moon by Les Paul and Barry Ford, it was a huge record, How High the Moon. And Les used to take his guitar and stack it many different times and then put a sound on it and would, you know, manipulate the sound of the guitar. So I tried doing that with the trumpet. I had two tape machines. I went from one tape machine to the other. And I came up with this sound, and when I heard it myself, it was like, bingo, man, I think I'm onto something. This is a good sound. And that was the genesis of the Tijuana Brass sound. And there were no other trumpets on the Tijuana Brass records. I played all the trumpet parts.
So in the vein of Harry James and Tommy Dorsey, you built a band around your trumpet, the Tijuana Brass. Can you tell me about how you found all those folks and why you decided to go down that road?
Well, actually, there was no Tijuana Brass. The first record I had was The Lonely Bull, and I just used musicians of my choice. And then we did the Lonely Bull album, same thing, musicians of my choice. And the second album was Volume 2. Again, it was just musicians that I felt could best play the sound I was looking for. Then the South of the Border album, same thing, and even through the Whipped Cream and Other Delights album, which was my biggest album. I think it sold 14 million copies and still going, still selling today. That was all done with musicians of my choice. You know, you heard about the Wrecking Crew and those guys.
Yes,
they
sir.
Were some of those guys were on my records. And then after I recorded the Whipped Cream album, I got a group together. I was hounded by, you know, the people that were working at A&M at the time, saying, man, you got to get a group together. We can promote you differently. It's going to be a whole different exposure. So I finally reluctantly got a group together. And from that point on, man, things really started open. The door opened wide open after I had that huge record of A Taste of Honey.
You kicked that door open. So tell me how you met Jerry Moss. So for folks listening, Jerry Moss and Herb Alpert started a record company in 1962 called A&M Records. How did you find Jerry, and what made you guys decide to start a record label?
Well, Jerry was a dear friend of a friend of mine, and he went to school with Jerry in New York and introduced me to Jerry. I think I met Jerry in New York. Jerry thinks he met me here in Los Angeles, but at any rate, we didn't really think about starting a record company. We were just putting out a record. And in those days, there were a lot of little record companies operating out of the trunks of their car. So we released this record. We had tremendous success on radio. And The Lonely Bull took off like a rocket ship. It zoomed up to, top 10 in the country and selling a lot of records, selling a lot of singles at the time. And I remember getting a letter from a lady in Germany who thanked me for sending her on this vicarious trip to Tijuana. And when I read it, I chuckled and I thought to myself, wow, that person is a good 7,000 miles away from Tijuana. And the music took her someplace. And I just at that point thought, that's the type of music I really want to make. I want to make music that takes you someplace. Not like elevator music, which can be okay, but you don't leave the elevator thinking about it. It's just kind of there. But I wanted to make music that conjured up good feelings.
I like that. Elevator music is sort of background music, and you wanted to make foreground music.
Well, oddly enough, this sounds a little corny, but I make music for myself. And if someone else likes it, I'm happy, because I had the opportunity to do The Lonely Bull, and most artists at that time would probably do The Lonely Bull sideways, The Lonely Bull, with a little left turn on it, The Lonely Bull with a little right turn. I didn't want to do that. I just left The Lonely Bull alone and started working on this sound that I knew was good. And I always tried to make records that made me feel good. And if they did make me feel good, then I would, put them out there. And if someone else liked it, great. If they didn't like it, great. This sounds weird, man. I was doing it for myself.
Well, I don't think it sounds weird. I love it. I think it was Gandhi said, be the change you want to see in the world. And I feel like a lot of creative people make the art they want to see in the world. So I think that makes 100% sense.
Yeah, I think so. I think the only criteria for being an artist is you have to be authentic. You have to be yourself. When I came to the realization that, man, I love Miles Davis. I think he's one of the greatest jazz trumpet players of all time. But trying to play like him doesn't make any sense, and I couldn't, even if I wanted to. But then I came to the realization, man, I can't do what he did, and he couldn't do what I do. So that's the deal.
Nice.
I stopped there. Yeah.
Hey, Streetwalkers. Here's a word from our sponsors.
This is Alan Bishop, head alchemist at Spirits of French Lake Distillery. We're glad to introduce to you our newest bottled and bond bourbons, the Lee W. Sinclair 4-Grain Bourbon and the Matty Gladden High Rye Bourbon. As always, these two bourbons are deeply rooted in the history of our location in the Black Forest of Southern Indiana. Always double pot distilled, never chill filtered, made using the finest grains, alternative and historic yeast strains that we propagate ourselves, and the methodology that once made Southern Indiana an epicenter of American distilling. Matured gracefully in 53-gallon No. 2 char, new American oak barrels, using a low 105 entry proof, the Lee Sinclair presents an oak forward profile, which pushes forward the definition and conversation about bourbon possibilities. While the Matty Gladden graces us and demonstrates respect with her 35% rye mash bill, it's not just the spirits in the bottle, it's the spirits of the place. Respect the grain and drink responsibly.
Let's get back into it.
So when you and Jerry decided to start A&M Records, how much of an actual decision was it after that first album? Because, like you said, you'd really just put that thing together to put out an album. So when was it apparent to you and Jerry that, hey, we got a thing here. We might want to keep doing this.
Well, the distributors that we had around the country said, why don't you guys just take the money and run, because you got lucky with this record, your proximity to Tijuana, and so it was a once in a lifetime. So that really piqued our interest. So we did the Lonely Bull album, which did really well, and we just wanted to see how long we could hang on to it. We kept reinvesting the money that we made from the Tijuana Brass albums, and little by little building a roster. And one thing led to another. We got lucky. One of the first artists we signed, it was 1964, we signed Waylon Jennings, who was a disc jockey in Phoenix. He also played bass and guitar, and he played gigs with Buddy Holly. And I used to go to Phoenix and record Waylon. There's a really great story that's attached to that, because I did a record with him called Four Strong Winds, a tune written by Bobby Bear. And Chet Atkins happened to hear the record and made some overtures to Waylon, which he probably shouldn't have done, because Waylon was under contract to us. And he said, you know, when he gets out of his contract with A&M, he'd love to talk to him, blah, blah, blah. Waylon told me about that. And at the time, I wanted to take Waylon just a little bit more pop. And Waylon's heart was really, he wanted to be a country artist. His soul was in country music.
Just a good old boy, never meaning no harm. Beats all you never saw, been in trouble with the law since the day they was born.
So I told my partner about that, what Chet Atkins had told Waylon, and we decided to let Waylon out of his contract in his best interest. And this was, I believe it was 1964, it might be 65, but anyways, the meat of the story is we decided to let him out of his contract. And I remember the day we signed his release, and I remember looking at my partner and said, man, this guy's going to be a big star. And my partner said, yeah, Jerry knew it as well. But at that point, man, I got goosebumps because I thought if we could be that honest with our artist and have that much integrity to let this guy out of his contract so he can follow his dream, we're going to be really successful. And that was at the point that I knew, man, there's nothing going to stop us. This is going to happen.
Well, with leadership like that at the top, it's no wonder that you guys were successful at A&M Records, because that is unheard of. Nobody lets anybody go for their best interests ever.
Well, especially somebody that you know is going to be a hit. I knew Waylon had something, man. He had some magic that it's hard to describe, and it's really hard to describe art as I see it. I mean, a good painting, a sculpture, a piece of music, a poetry, whatever it is, it's all about a feel, you know? I mean, music is not what you hear or see. It's what you feel, and that's when music really strikes home. And if you try analyzing it too much, if you try to get into the nitty-gritty and the minutia of why it was recorded and who did this and the bass, listen to that bass player, you're going to miss it's an overall feeling. And I think that's what's so beautiful about art. The mystery of art is the thing that keeps me going.
Yeah, I think it's great. I mean, you know, a piece of art, whether it's visual or audio, it could speak to you but not speak to me. But it's still art, and that's okay. Everything is not for everybody.
Yeah, no, you have to be select. I mean, it's like, I use this example a lot. It's like if you stand in front of a Jackson Pollock painting, if you know Jackson Pollock's work, and you look at it and you say, holy moly, man, this thing is a mess. He has paint all over the place. It's like scrambling up. It looks crazy to me. Well, you'll never get the painting. It'll blow right by you. If you just stand in front of it without thinking and just feel it and look at it, it'll either really get you where it's supposed to or not. But if you start analyzing art, it's a lost cause.
I agree. I used to, if I didn't like something, I used to be in the mindset of, you know, oh, that sucks. But a friend of mine, a buddy named Steve, he sort of turned me around on that with the easiest phrase ever. That's not for me. It doesn't suck. It's just not for me. You know, sort of like your dad and his manufacturing clothing business. It didn't suck, but it just wasn't for you. So I think that if less people had the attitude like I did previously of, you know, this sucks or that sucks, and more along the lines of that's just not for me, I think maybe we'd be a little happier as people.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. You know, like in 1968, a guy came in to A&M Records, to my office there, and played me a master. And they were looking for a company to distribute this record. And I listened to it, and I thought to myself, man, this is too long. It's out of tune. I heard the original record years and years ago that was much better. I hate this thing. I didn't tell him that. I just said, man, I have to pass on it. But just because I ain't receiving your message here, it doesn't mean you ain't sending anything. So don't get discouraged, but we're going to pass on it. Anyways, I passed on that record, which happened to be Louie Louie.
That's awesome.
And it was like number one for 8 weeks in a row. And every time I heard it, I still had the same feeling. Man, I didn't like the record. I thought it was out of tune. I went through the same thing. So I never regretted it. But yeah, who knows what a hit record is? Luck has to be on your side. And I think one of the main things that I can bring to this conversation is about A&M and myself and, you know, the success I've had. I was at the right place at the right time, and I was prepared because I did my homework. But timing, you need to have timing on your side. And if we tried to start A&M Records in today's environment, it would not have happened.
Yeah, that makes 100% sense. You know, time and place for everything.
Yeah.
And I guess the trick is to be ready if that time happens for you. It doesn't happen for everybody, but if it does, be ready or it'll pass you by. You'll miss it.
Yeah.
Now, you have some of the most iconic songs. And I know that a lot of artists, when I talk to them, there's a song that they really, really enjoy playing on stage, maybe a little more than some others. I was talking to one of the Commodores, and his favorite song to play on stage, at least for a while, was a real funky tune called Gimme My Mule, which is about 7 minutes of just funk. And he said that's one of the most fun songs to play on stage. So of all of your hits, even your non-hits, of all of your songs, what is the one that you enjoy playing in front of people the most, that brings you the most joy to play?
Well, that's a good question, but I don't think of it that way, because I'm basically a jazz musician of the moment, and whatever I play, it's going to have the moment's feeling on it. So each night will be different. I don't have a carbon copy of playing a song exactly the way it was. There's always that nuance that I don't know what's going to happen until I do it. So each song I play that we choose to play has a very improvisational component to it.
Gotcha. Well, without giving any figures, because I definitely don't want that, is there one song that has been the most financially lucrative for you in your career?
Lucrative is another question. That's a tough question. I wouldn't know.
Okay. That's cool. That's cool. You have a song called Spanish Flea that was a huge hit. And I think that was the theme song from maybe some game show a long time ago.
Yeah, they did use that song. And then when that song was presented to me, the original title was Spanish Fly. I said, no, man, we can't use that title. How about Spanish Flea?
Nice. That's funny.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, especially, looking back in today's climate, that was an even better decision maybe now than it was back then. So good job.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Well, since Spanish Flea was one of your biggest hits and you just told that really funny story about it, can I play Spanish Flea?
Yeah, of course you can play it.
Awesome. Thanks. Now, I also know that you do sort of a Herb Alpert version of some newer songs. Like, I think you did a Jason Mraz song, and I think you and your wife did that, right?
Oh, no, I did it. It's called I'm Yours. It's a great song. I just tried to do it in a way that was different than the version that Jason had. But I guess, you know, one of the biggest songs I had was Rise, which was a huge success on all formats. And I have the distinction of having the only, you know, number one record as a singer, This Guy's in Love with You, and as instrumentalist, Rise, in 1979. So I'm proud of that particular accomplishment.
Well, you should. That is amazing. And I believe it still holds true today. It wasn't that you were the first. It's that you're still the only.
I was the only one. Only one. Step right up, folks, and buy it. No, yeah, I think it's a nice one. It's going to be hard to break that one.
Well, that is the truth. Now, speaking of Rise, I love that song. Arguably, that's one of my favorite of your songs. You can say no, and I'll cut this out. That's fine. But can I play Rise?
Why not? Yeah.
Oh, sweet. Thanks. I love it.
Oh, of course.
Thank you.
Hey, Streetwalkers, here's a word from our sponsors.
Hi, guys, I'm Vinny Tartarich. I'm the guy that has the Fitness Confidential podcast and the book by the same name. I've started a few companies, but I just started a company called NSNG Foods, and our first product is Ultra Fat. What's that? You say fat? Oh, yeah, it's got fat in it. It's got Ultra Fat, and the reason we call it Ultra Fat is because it also has electrolytes. So this is something you want to take when you're on the move, taking the nation and the world by storm. We have the coffee almond with coconut and vanilla. We also have the one with coconut, vanilla, and almonds with no coffee. So you can go check it all out, nsngfoods.com. Now go listen to my good friend Steve Owens because he knows what he's talking about.
Let's get back into it.
I do appreciate your time. After I get off the phone with you, I'm going to intro the movie and play the trailer for the movie.
Ah, great.
Congratulations, by the way. I understand it came out today on VOD. I'm excited to see it myself.
Thank you.
All right, cool. Well, I know you're a busy guy. I will let you go. And Herb Alpert, thank you again so much for taking the time out of your busy day to hang out and let us get to know you a little bit better on Fascination Street. I feel like I could talk to you all day, so I appreciate the time you did give me.
Great, Steve. Oh, no, I appreciate you, and thanks for the questions. I had some fun time answering some of those questions that aren't thrown at me exactly like the way you posed them, so it was good.
Well, thank you very much. Just real quick, is your wife on social media? I would love to reach out to her as well. She's amazing.
She doesn't know how to get onto social media.
Okay. All right, no worries.
She keeps telling me, how do you do that again? Shame into it. But she's a hell of a singer and a wonderful cook.
Well, I understand you're very lucky, man.
An angel, man. I married an angel.
More power to you and her.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. All right, Herb, you have a great rest of your day.
Okay, man. Thanks, Steve. Be safe.
Yes, sir. You too. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Herb Alpert, legendary musician, artist, and philanthropist, has sold more than 72 million albums, 29 of them gold or platinum. He outsold the Beatles in 1966 and co-founded A&M Records, the most successful independent record company in history. Herb Alpert is a documentary based on the life and experiences of Herb Alpert, directed by John Sheinfeld, and it looks at Herb's extraordinary life with rare footage and interviews with colleagues like Sting and Questlove. Available now, so check your streaming services.
Good evening. I'm Herb Alpert, and welcome.
Herb Alpert is a cultural icon.
Funky.
Herb Alpert is always the coolest person in the room.
He's always just Herbie.
Tijuana Brass became that universal sound.
It's the happiest music in existence.
I was born in Boyle Heights, east of L.A.
My father came to this country when he was 16 years old, on a boat, by himself.
When I was in about the third grade, I happened to pick up the trumpet because it fit in my hand.
One day I was playing and one of the neighbors yelled out, "Hold it down!" And my mom opened the window and she said, "He's going to play louder."
He had a jazz propensity, but it was influenced by the mariachis.
Tijuana Brass was everywhere.
We have been playing music and the crew reports Herb Alpert sounds great.
1966, 5 songs in the top 10, sold more records than the Beatles.
We were selling out these huge arenas in 3 minutes. And at that point, I realized, man, I'm rich, I'm famous, but I'm miserable.
You see,
I was treated like a number. Shouldn't a record company revolve around the artist? I thought, if I've ever had my own record company, that's what I would do first and foremost.
And that was the start of A&M Records.
I never tried to make a hit record. I always tried to make a good record. If it touches me emotionally, I'm in. I use that process for painting and sculpting.
All of the artists at A&M felt they were part of a family.
Herb empowered so many others.
It was like a paradise for creativity.
He has built his career on touching people, not just through songs, but through his philanthropy.
I just feel like I have to do it. I've been blessed way, way beyond my dreams.
I don't think people listen with their ears. I think they listen with their soul.
The fact that Herb is still making records and performing is remarkable.
You never really get to the end product. You never get there. That's the seductive part of being an artist.
Herb Alpert is butter.
As always, thanks for listening, Streetwalkers. And don't forget, follow the show on Twitter at FascinationSTPD, on Instagram at FascinationStreetPod. Follow the podcast page on Facebook at Fascination Street Podcast. And of course, you can always email me at FascinationStreetPod@gmail.com. And if you haven't already, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button and rate us on iTunes.
Opening music is the song Magnolia from the 2014 album Intransigence. Used with permission from Douglas Miles Clark. Closing music is Apollo from the 2001 album Into the Known by the band Sapphire. Thanks for hanging out with us and getting to know a little bit about our guest. We'll see you next time on Fascination Street.